Okay.
All right. In his 1989 publication, Medicine and Film, a Checklist, Survey and Research Resource, the film historian Michael Shortland states that medicine was the first profession to be depicted in film. And I'm going to just share my screen now. Right. And probably one of the first medical films was Georges Méliès' Doctor's Secret. It's a bit of a dark film, this one. It says, because here doctors blew a patient to pieces in a hydrotherapy machine and then reassembled him. And actually some of the skills that were used in this were I can see me clapping. It's funny, these two first films kind of pick the two sides of medicine and film, this extraordinary kind of like sci-fi side of it. And this was actually started working on this in 1902. And then second one is a much milder one. It's D.W. Griffith's The Country Doctor. And here Griffiths explores the life of a country doctor. And actually, when we look at ER or any of these, how many spin-offs do we have now? We seem to have a certain obsession with the life of those in the medical profession. Moreover, it started in 1910 when we had the first production of Frankenstein, but it was in the cinema that Victor Frankenstein was transformed from a student of natural sciences to a medical student. And Robert Vines, the Cabinet of Dr Caligari, still used today in film cycles on mental health, even though it's a 1920s production. Curiously, my first opportunity to see this film occurred in one such cycle. Cycles of Cinema and Mind film cycle run at Qualus to the Gulbenkian Foundation Center for Modern Art in 2010. And I'm going to quote João Mário Grilo, Portuguese film director and scholar, who curated this cycle on his selection process, as I consider this highlights how the long-standing connection between cinema and medicine plays out. He was not concerned with producing an anthology, but rather with leaving a testimony that illustrated how mental problems were always present to a greater or lesser extent in the development of cinema through the 20th century, and also accompanying the century's social concerns about the way in which people regarded transformation and change, end quote. I consider the presence of Grillo refers to applies across all fields of healthcare, not just mental health, and continues into the 21st century, as Grillo himself implies with the inclusion of Gus Van Sant's 2003 Elephant in his cycle. Moreover, it is not only cinema scholars who look at film as a way of gaining insight into the connections between cinema, its representations of illness and wellness, mental health and illness. Reviewing the impact of the Cabinet of Dr. Caligari in light of its 100th anniversary, a team from the School of Medicine and Surgery, University of Milano, Monza, and the Department of Clinical Surgical Diagnostic and Pediatric Sciences, University of Paiva, led by D. Sacchini, concluded that, and I quote, "Movies might be a useful tool to understand how audience perceive science and medicine nowadays and in past times. But some doctors and healthcare professionals have gone even further. For instance, we have the case of this volume here by Peter D. E. Dens, Doctors in Movies. It's a 2000 volume. And he sets out to portray medicine how Hollywood has seen medicine over the last 60 years. He is a Johns Hopkins University of Medicine faculty member and an internalist. Dens, in his introduction, explains the role he feels Hollywood cinema has played in shaping not only how doctors think of themselves, but also in creating and reinforcing stereotypes. And I quote, "Myths like denial is central to human existence. History may tell us what we have been, but myths tell us what we could have been and still might be, as well as what others think we are. In this century, the most influential myth makers have been movie makers. It, the Hollywood dream machine, has shaped how we think about ourselves and those around us by reinforcing stereotypes or creating new ones. And there are a number of works of this type. The most recent one was published in 2020. It's this Elenko Wijek's Cinema MD, A History of Medicine on Screen. And this sets out to analyze how doctors, nurses, hospitals, and health conditions have been portrayed in films over the last century. And in this, there are actually 400 films analyzed. So this is what is really interesting about all of these books so far and the studies is that they are being produced by medical professionals. They're not being produced by literary scholars. And it goes even further. We have this these two volumes that were produced by Matthew Alexander. We put here, he has two main collaborators, Patricia Leenan and Anna Pavlov. But actually in over 50 medical professionals, healthcare professionals, because it's not just doctors, it's also nurses and social workers, have contributed to these volumes. And what they've actually done is they have divided the book like it's into its segments. So you have a segment about Alzheimer's, you have a segment about bipolar disorder, you have a segment about cancer. And they have selected excerpts of films, not whole films, excerpts of films. They give you the timestamps and they give you an introduction. And they give trainers a kind of set of questions that they can use to prepare their students for watching the scene and then discussion questions as well. And like for instance, we've got the many scenes from the film, very famous film, The Doctor, are used to help students think about their relationship with patients and how they can best improve this. So on the one hand, this seems like a very kind of positive thing, but on the other hand, there has been positive feedback to Alexander's method because it offers these ready-made, easy-to-use lesson plans. There has also been criticism, as you can imagine, as it's seen as mechanical and not engaging deep thought or critical thinking. And these, like the deep thought and the critical thinking are the aspects that are associated with using the humanities using the arts in healthcare education. I suppose for that reason, there was this rebuttal of this by Brian Glazer, who is a professor in medical humanities. And he says, and I quote himself in the blurge for the book, this medicinema, doctors and films, this is responding to cinema education, which focused on the use of cinema in medical teaching. This book instead examines what film has to say about medicine, its practitioners, and their cultural meaning. And the review, this I think is very interesting, this review by Tony Mixon-Eck. He says, any bond between filmmakers and physicians is formed by a shared interest in narrative, both hearing and sharing stories. Additional moving pictures and medical practitioners rely primarily on two senses, sight and sound. So here, Glasser is trying to get back to this more reflective approach. And why am I talking about these things? I'm talking about these things because, as you see, there has been this apparently very long-standing connection between film and medicine. And film appears to be a very easy-to-use method. But if you go down kind of the easy road that Alexander goes down, you probably don't get the depth out of the interaction of film that you could if you use more reflective methods, which is what I'm going to talk about in the third section when I talk about applying narrative medicine techniques to film and give some examples as well. So then just to finish off this section, I think this is just, this I'm referring here to a very interesting study which was carried out by Mary Harman in 2004. Mary Harman is associate dean and nursing professor at Glendick Mercy College, Pennsylvania. And she carried out the survey linking liberal and professional learning in nursing education. And she found that film, because she this study is, it was kind of the groundbreaking study in this area. Many studies have been based on this afterwards. And what she found was that the critical thinking that came when nursing students, she was speaking specifically about nursing students, but she also included medical training in her study. When medical and nursing students were allowed to interact creatively, reflectively with the arts, they were able to develop the kind of critical thinking that she considers is necessary for addressing, as we see here in the end, the unscripted problems that would surface in real practice. She found that film was the activity in 2004 when she did her study. She found 83 activities that were associated and 34 with literature, and then with art as well, it was in the 30s. And here she talked about how film, why, and then she had these long interviews with, scripted interviews with trainers, and she found that, that the faculty considered film could break down the barriers of apathy that had been brought up by overexposure to events in society. And I'll read this quote here because I think it's all very relevant. So according to Herman, faculty discussed the highly effective way that an appropriate film illustrates a concept and stimulates different study student learning styles. Since today's students have grown up within a peer culture of electronic violence, indifference and apathy may prevail. Thus, one challenge in viewing these films is to create learning activities that penetrate this possible numbness, and several faculty emphasize the necessity for faculty to create well-conceived discussion questions, not the kind of Alexander questions, to drive the critical thinking process. Thoughtful reflection guided by a humanistic educator can serve to ready the student for addressing unscripted problems that will start in real life. And we will pick up on this when in the third section, when I'm talking about how narrative medicine methods can be used, because I think they provide this humanistic guide that can lead to the kind of questions that can help develop this critical thinking and prepare future healthcare professionals for challenges that 21st century present. But why film? Actually, before going on, because up until now, except for this, why film? Why can film work well? Why does it seem like it is the idea? It is an excellent medium for working in health humanities or others. So this is where we move on to David Bardwell and Kristen Thompson in their seminal work, Film, Art, and Introduction. And one of the first things that they comment on, and I'm not going to read this whole quote, but I'll just leave it here. It says, the first thing it says, with film, viewers can see ordinary, everyday things, like someone falling on the street. But if we see Buster Keating falling on the street, or we see Charlie Chaplin falling on the street, it would be very different to seeing our next door neighbor falling on the street. So we get used to the idea that here we have, it's a construct. There is this notion that context creates meaning, you know. So we have in film, the meaning is created very, very definitely by the way the events are presented. They're constructed through on-screen framing to produce different meanings. You can have the same event producing different meanings as you change the on-screen framing. Also, film invites active participation with the events being portrayed on screen. The viewer is actively involved in creating and readjusting expectations as patterns outside of or even inside of norms develop. And I quote here, you as a viewer or listener don't simply let the parts parade past you. You enter into an active participation with them, creating and readjusting expectations as the pattern develops. And this is one of the things as well, when we're looking at whole films, we see that often we are prepared, the viewer is prepared for changes in plot lines visually at the very beginning or before this happens. So this is this creating and readjusting of expectations and pattern development. So we are active viewers. In a narrative film as well, viewers observe and engage with characters, expecting them to follow a traditional flow of narrative progression, like confrontation, conflict, and resolution. And I've been saying, however, plot twists are hinted at through visual means, so viewers become actively involved in observation. Here I quote again, in any narrative film, either fictional or documentary, and one thing that's very important here, if the film follows a narrative style, it doesn't matter an awful lot whether it's documentary or fictional. Characters create meaning characters create causes and register effects. Within the film's formal system, they make things happen and respond to events. Their actions and reactions contribute greatly to our engagement with film. So we are talking about seeing things differently, about active involvement with the story as it is developing. And we are also talking about acting and reacting to plot changes. So it's a very all-inclusive activity of, you know, this being watching a movie. And then finally, viewers' observation requires reading different affects and actions. This is unlike characters in novels. Film characters typically have a visible body. Along with the body, a character has traits. Traits are attitudes, skills, habits, tastes, psychological drives, and any other qualities that distinguish. Thus, the viewer is actively involved in the storytelling at all levels and can learn much and enters the experience. Curiously or not, Antonio Damasio presents a model for the development of consciousness, incorporating three supporting levels of self, proto-self, core self, autobiographical self, which he feels may explain contemporary fascination with moving images on screen. Now, I'm not going to go into his theory of self-construction of self, but I am going to just show you a quotation on where he develops his concept of how films may mimic creation of thought, the creation of consciousness process. He considers that before we have words, we have a kind of a pictorial thinking. And here I quote from his 2000 book, The Feeling of What Happens, Body, Emotion, and the Making of Consciousness. And I quote, wordless storytelling is natural. The imagetic representation of sequences of brain events which occur in brains simpler than ours is stuff of which stories are made. A neutral, pre-verbal occurrence of storytelling may well be the reason why we ended up creating drama and eventually books, and why a good part of humanity is currently hooked on movie theaters and television screens. This was written in 2000, so we didn't have smartphone screens here yet, but we can add them as well. It says, movies are the closest external representation of the prevailing storytelling that goes on in our minds. It is this storytelling, this pictorial storytelling that he considers precedes language as we are creating our core self and autobiographical. It says, what goes on within each shot, different framing of a subject that the movement of the camera can accomplish, what goes on in the transition of the shots achieved by editing, and what goes on in the narrative construction by a particular juxtaposition of shots is comparable in some respects what is going on in the mind, thanks to the machinery in charge of making visual and auditory images, and to devices such as many levels of attention and working memory. This is his theory. It's not fact. Just because a scientist says it, it's not true. But this is his theory. This is the way he thinks that thought is formed, going from the pictorial to the and later to the verbal. So if Bordwell and Thompson have illustrated how aesthetics and language of cinema have contributed it to being a medium that facilitates the capacity to see things of ordinary or everyday life differently, to engage with characters and dialogues on screen, Damasio speaks to the biological underpinnings that facilitate this interaction. This is just a very, very brief look at why maybe film works in the way it does. Now we'll come back to using narrative medicine methods with film, how we can do this, and how we can maybe, how the narrative medicine methods can improve what has been done so far. So since 2019, I've been teaching a number of film semiotics modules in an elective in the medical school, summer schools and seminars in the nursing school, and even in the curricular unit in our own faculty of the School of Arts and Humanity. So I'm going to speak about some of the experiences I've had while I was working with this. But I want to return to Mary Harman's ending salvo, where she says that, this is her opening salvo, but this was she opens her survey with this statement, which is a strong statement. She says, various liberal education courses have provided a wonderful and enriching antidote to the mechanistic and reductionistic methods that have historically prevailed in both medical and nursing training. And she concludes that thoughtful reflection, and she was speaking there specifically about film, but would apply to any other of the arts, guided by a humanistic educator, can serve to ready the student for addressing the unscripted problems that will surface in real practice. However, Harman was nothing if she was not pragmatic. And she also presented the problems that she of implementing humanities-based programs, and she was speaking specifically of nursing training, but it applies across the healthcare board. So it was the lack of preparation of nursing faculty as educators. So this is why, for instance, a product like Alexander's, and here I can even show it, I have it here, it's in education, it would work very well for somebody who wants kind of a quick fit. Then we have the constant the content-driven nature of faculty. So we need to get content. We need to get all of the most important content done first. Soft skills are not so important. You know, that's not true. Number three, this is one that a lot of people do not consider, but what we have seen that it's very true. It's the time-consuming aspect of developing these alternative strategies. So you're actually talking about changing the way you think about training. So it is a time-consuming process. And then there's also beliefs that the core curriculum should take care of the liberal arts. So we'll show a film, you know. So we're doing anatomy, or we're doing this. So we'll show a film that's relevant. And then that's, you know, the humanities aspect taken care of. And while it would, obviously, like if we look at what's happening in the school, in the College of Physicians and Surgeons in Columbia University, narrative medicine methods are taken care of in core curriculum. They have other electives, but they also have specific electives where the students learn to interact with the methods on their own. So it's very important that even though you can introduce them in core curriculum, they should have their own space as well. And finally, the external standardized tests fail to capture requisite qualities of a compassionate student and inhibit pedagogical innovations. This is, you know, this is one of the things. You do not have that many qualitative studies in this area because it's hard. But still, because the narrative medicine methods can help overcome the problems here. Because first of all, we've got this, the tools of close reading and reflective and creating writing. They're based on a humanistic approach to education. So this is what Herman said as being necessary, this humanistic approach where this they include this. The second one, the methods facilitate a critical interaction with the arts that can stimulate learning styles with the ability to penetrate numbness and apathy. And then finally, the fact that you have an example like the program that's running in school, in the Department of Medical Humanities and Ethics at Columbia University, this helps. Okay, so just a very brief, many of you already know how narrative medicine workshops work, some of you may not, so I'll just very, very briefly state what happens, and then I'll state how we can adapt, how we can work with film within this context. So narrative medicine teaches the skills of close reading, creative reflective writing written in the shadow of the text read. And then this text is close read in groups of 3 to 5 participants. And Sharon, I beg your pardon, yes. And these skills lead to the development of attention, representation, and affiliation. Close reading is the signature tool of narrative medicine. It enhances caregivers' ability to be more present in the moment and thus pay more attention to what is happening in the consultation. It also helps develop a listening ear, attention to nuance, and this ear will be, and then here I quote this from Sharon, says, literary studies train students in close reading in which the reader pays attention to the multiple dimensions of the text at once. The genre, the imagery, the temporality, the allusions to other texts, and to the onset. Attentive listening to oral language is akin to close reading of a written text, and training in close reading is also is seen to translate into improved attention and listening to oral language. So, but however, for me personally, the most impactful moments are the creative writing and reading of this text in small groups. In this reading aloud and response, participants are offered the opportunity to have a hearer for their words. As this listening is done in a literary close reading, participants learn the significance of what they have written when it is responded to. For instance, a prose text becomes a poem as it is read, and the depth of metaphor is understood. When this act of reading and responding is repeated, the ability to put into words that which is seen and felt grows, and participants build affiliations with self and others as trust and recognition grows in the group. In the narrative medicine workshop, we have a 5-minute close reading, and then this is followed by the creative and reflective. So how can this be transferred to film? Okay, first of all, working with a variety of film skills and for appropriate identification, participants learn how to read film stills. I use Bardwell and Thompson's methods here. And then they practice close reading and they're comfortable discussing the visual elements and how these guide meaning. And then finally, we start working with film stills and excerpts in narrative medicine style exercises. And here, these are this some examples, like for instance, with this film still from James Mangold, Girl Interrupted, students are first invited to do a denotative reading, to do a close reading of the elements, connotative reading, so how these elements make meaning. And then their writing exercise here would be, they'll write for 5 minutes to the prompt, I'll take care of you. And this sounded better in Portuguese. These are direct translations and they just kind of don't work like in the same way. Another example here, this is from Isabel Coche's My Life Without Me. Again, students do an individual denotative reading, and we have a class discussion about the annotative reading, and then they write to this more open prompt time, you know, because of course one of the characters in this film still is the clock that's cut in half. And Then just another final example, this is from Dan Krauss's documentary Extremis, which is set in a palliative, it's a documentary film, a Netflix film in a palliative care ward. And again, the participants, they do a denotative and a connotative reading, and then they write this prompt, and now what? So these are kind of examples of the exercises, and the writing exercises and the responding, it always happens that as the students read it, they write things they often never thought they would write, or there's just this exploration of thought, is this deep exploration of thought, which is really very, I think it gives them a layer of depth to think about things. Sometimes they're not necessarily personal reflections. We're not looking for them to bare their hearts. This is not what it's about. It's about them learning to look more deeply and also to represent accurately in words that which they see and feel. And then often this discussion, this close read, as they read the text together, they kind of understand the depth of what they are. Their listeners give them more meaning. Which is I have to admit, it's kind of a wonderful process. So here, these I think are the learning activities that penetrate this possible numbness that Herman spoke about, and develop the well-conceived discussion questions to drive the critical thinking process. You don't have questions, like the only question we really have is the prompt, but they develop their own critical thinking, and this is a really interesting, and it's an individual. It never works that, like, you can use the same film still with different groups, and you never get the same answers, and that's what is really, really interesting. So once the students have had, you know, some practice of working with visual aspects, understanding how meaning is made through visual aspects and the other elements of film, we can move on to work with old films. Now, Mara Spiegel, again, she is probably one of the collaborators of Rita Sharon, who's worked most with film, and she defends very much the use of complete films, because one of the things about working with a whole film is there are so many things going on in a film at the same time, of course, but there are also so many things going on in life. And sometimes there can be just one little thing that sticks in your mind. You know, there's something that's quite significant about that, but you can ignore it. And then you see its significance later on in the film. And I might show you a short excerpt that illustrates just this. Here it says, because when we look at the film, we look at the discussion film as a whole, as a story, using narrative skills to engage with characters, their trajectories, and to follow their stories and engage with their narrative context. Now, I'm going to show you a very short excerpt from James Mengel's. I'm going to have to interrupt I'm going to have to interrupt, and I will share again. I'm just going to show you this 1 minute. Just give you a little background. I'll just let you watch the still on its own. James Mangold's Girl Interrupted, and here we've got, in this, just to contextualize the scene, it unfolds between three characters: Lisa, who is a charismatic sociopath, who's played by Angelina Jolie, a junior nurse, Nurse Marge, who's played by Christina Myers, and the head nurse, Nurse Valerie, played by Whoopi. Do you see it?
Yes.
Can you see?
Yes.
Ah, okay. Very good, very good. Hold on a second. Sending.
from here.
Okay. All right. Very good. So here we have this very short excerpt, and obviously, but if we look at this one scene, the element that stands out is how it's diffused by Nurse Valerie. However, if one has an awareness of the whole story, or the whole story that the film presents, of the relationship between Lisa and Nurse Marge, one is aware of many slips that Margie, because I don't know if you noticed, but Lisa calls the nurse, she doesn't say nurse, she calls her Margie, permits. And there are a number of tiny little excerpts where she appears to want Lisa to like her and to think she's cool as well. And because of that, Lisa is queen of cool here, played by Angelina Donet. But because of this, when it comes to this scene, Marge has absolutely no authority. So why do I really like to use this with film? It is because of the many little incidents that lead up to this main incident. If we just look at this scene on its own, we are just looking at how Nurse Valerie diffuses the scene. But if you look at the film as a whole, you can see how Margie presents herself to Lisa allows this to happen. So this is why it is much more interesting. So watching complete films promotes awareness of the alterations in characters' affect the stories are told, but it also to encourage recognition of multiple dynamic stories and single plots, and an awareness of how stories begin and end, develop and intersect, as Spiegel proposes. And it also permits a discussion of other elements of film language and how these influence characters' expectation and narrative development. So if one is to teach narrative competence, of course, relevant to introduce students also to the concept of narrative construction and show how this works. So at this stage, there's also a film that I really like to use a lot, which is, I'll go back to there's something here on the back up. You cannot hear. Chiara said that you couldn't hear, but can you hear now? Is it okay now?
I can hear your voice. I couldn't hear the film.
Ah, okay. Ah, I beg your pardon. Okay. Then I'm really sorry. I thought it had gone.
It was my problem. I don't know if the other.
Did the rest of you hear? You didn't hear. Hold on a minute. I can show it again. Hold on a minute.
Thank you.
Because I forgot to do one thing, which it's jumping around. I beg your pardon, I should have, Now it doesn't want to, I beg your pardon, now it doesn't want to cooperate with me. Oh, okay, right. But in this scene, there was this, I'm sorry about that. But with this scene, what happens, what you didn't hear is Lisa, Nurse Smart, is doing the checks. And Lisa says Lisa stops her, and then she threatens to kill, to stab herself in the aorta. So this is why it's Nurse Valerie stops this whole thing. She says, "Lisa, your aorta is in your chest." So this is how she diffuses the situation. And so it was a pity that didn't work. Right. But also, again, we talk about narrative construction, how this works, how narratives work, where we present the presentation of the characters and the events and the event and the conflict and the resolution. And when we, and I will just share my screen, when we do this, there's one film that I really like to work with, which is Making Rounds. It's a documentary film, but it's a film it's a film where the doctors who appear in this film, they have really understood the concept of how narratives are constructed. Now, I'll give you this. This is a scene. I'll tell you a little bit about this film. This is Making Rounds. It's a Verite-style documentary. Muffie Meyer follows two leading cardiologists from Mount Sinai Hospital, Dr. Valentin Fursten and Dr. Skyerloff, over a one-month period as they care for and train junior doctors. This is something they do every year for a month. And they teach these young doctors to actively listen to the patients. As their years of experience have shown them that William Osler, the founder of the residency program, John Hopkins, was actually right when he professed over and over again, listen to the patient, he will tell you the diagnosis. But another thing that they have, which is quite extraordinary, and the first time I watched the film, I was absolutely amazed when I saw it, is they are not only skilled physicians who listen attentively to their patients, they've also dominated the art of narrative storytelling in their clinical consultation. Like, for instance, if we look at this still, and this is, I normally begin working with this film still, and I ask the students to do a denotative reading, so to read the images, to see what the story is telling through the image. Then I ask them to do a connotative reading, what this means, and then I asked them to do a writing exercise, so I had to describe the scene from the perspective of one of the doctors. And normally, because of the posture, the position, the response of the patient, they are, most of the times they presume that the patient has had successful surgery. And that she's thanking her surgeons, and maybe she's getting ready to be released from hospital even because of the construction. And then we watch the film. And it's a bit of a shock when they watch the film and they realize that this patient who is identified as Mercedes G, she's actually very, very sick. When the doctors Burston and Skylar are actually leaving her bedside here, she's still waiting for a heart transplant. And all that has happened here is that she's told her story and she's been listened to. And it's been quite a short conversation. It's been like about a 3 or 4 minute conversation. But then, but she was allowed to tell it, and she was allowed to tell it in sequence. And then before leaving, Dr. Fursten notices a medical technical detail that must be verified. And they do this before leaving her bedside. And then the encounter ends. And the encounter ends with this. This is the dialogue. And this is, if this is what is being said at this moment that you're watching this film still. So it says, Dr. Forster says, thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to say a few words, okay? Because, and she says, you're welcome. And he said, it's a pleasure. best luck to you. He is Spanish, Dr. Ferguson, so there are sometimes his English, he leaves his English, has some of the prepositions missing sometimes. This is a very simple exchange. There's no deception or offering of false hope, just a simple human exchange. Delivered looking the patient in the eye, thanking her sincerely for her permission to discuss her case with the team. And it's sealed with a genuine handshake. Dr. Förster does not mislead Mercedes J. He doesn't promise her a cure, but he listens to her. And he is careful to end their consultation properly, to bring resolution, if not conclusion, to the scene. And this scene occurs at minute 17 of the film. At the end of the film, we discover that Mercedes Jess was still waiting for her heart, for the new heart, but she's hopeful and fighting to wait for this. This narrative pattern, representation of all the players in the event, discussion of the event, illness and resolution, if not conclusion, seen in all of the consultations that both Skylar and Ferguson perform, even if they each have their own individual style, which is also very nice to see. They operate in a very different way. And this, of course, leads to long discussions with the students. I've used this film mostly with medical students during the Medical Humanities elective, and each student have to write a short 1,000-1,500-word assignment on one of the either literature or film or theater that they've been exposed to during using art medicine techniques. Interestingly, some students have actually analyzed narrative development in this film or others, and something I believe that will help them understand how to engage in medical consultations. And I think these methods, they answer the proposals that Herman had placed in her study, that a new century poses daunting challenges stem from myriad factors such as scientific advancement, clinical knowledge, expanding technology, increased client diversity, market-driven policies, ethical and judicial issues, and global awareness. And the integration of the humanities has been described as one curricular aspect that supports the growth of critical thinking in a humanistic approach, as well as the personal and professional development of the nursing student. And, this is, I think, but it's got to be this kind of an integrated reflective approach, not kind of a quick fit like the cinema education of Alexander. And I think this is where narrative medicine enters. And just one final, idea point before I leave. One of the things that really, really surprised me as well when I was doing this research was the amount of short films that have been made recently that illustrate fragilities in difficulties that professionals may need, like in Making Rounds, Skylar and Frustin, they talk about the difficulties that young doctors face today. And they talk about their own effort to try to overcome that. And they're speaking about this openly, which is something we kind of don't associate with healthcare professionals. And we also have like these two films, these Netflix films, Endgame and Extremis, which look at end of life care. And this is something that doctors for a very long time have actually had difficulty of dealing with, because they are trained to heal. They're not trained to help people or let people die. So it is really interesting to see the voices being in these films. We see not a justification, an explanation, and maybe a justification as well of why end of life care is so important and how this honors the patient. But that these are, so this is why I think that in today's world, cinema is also becoming, it's also offering agency. Because this happens as well for technological reasons, like films like Endgame and Extremis and even Muffie Meyer's Making Rounds would have been impossible to make even 10 years ago, because you'd have to bring in a whole camera crew, whereas now it can be done with a small handheld camera. And so technological advances have allowed less intrusive filming, but it seems that it is offering a voice to those who want to present their case, which may not be a case that is so often heard. And then finally, I just leave you with this Health for All, this film festival that's been promoted by the World Health Organization, started in 2020. And here we see films from the perspective of the patient, of the carer, of social activists. But the one film that I really loved, I don't know if I'll be able to show it to you, but I can try. It is The Beat of Change, Turning the Tide. This it was made in Mozambique. This is quite a professional film because it's got a background behind it. But for one of the first times in this film, what we see is we hear the voice of the patient as she tells her story on the one hand, and we hear the voice of a healthcare professional who talks about the problems that are associated with dealing with this very curable disease in a country where care is not so easily available. And what I find found particularly moving about this film was the fact that they are placed at equal sides. I don't know, would you like to see this film? It's about 4 minutes, if it will work.
Yes. Yes, yeah. Please.
Hopefully this will work and I won't have the same problem that I had with the other one. I've optimized them. Can you hear?
Comecei a ficar inflamada.
Yes.
Comecei a sentir dor no peito. Não conseguia carregar o bebê. Comecei a me sentir mal. Comecei a respirar mal. Me senti tão mal. E deixar minha filha sozinha, sem mãe. Até que não acreditava que ia voltar ao normal.
At the moment, about 30 million people live with rheumatic heart disease in the world, the same number of people living with HIV/AIDS. The only really big difference is that rheumatic heart disease is not supported by a major organization, and 100 times more funding goes into HIV/AIDS than in rheumatic heart disease.
Taking data from surrounding countries, at least 25,000 people a year in Mozambique may be dying. It affects predominantly women. When you get pregnant, you have more symptoms and more clinical signs that you had before.
Já não estou a estudar, já não estou a trabalhar. Parei tudo.
Rheumatic heart disease is caused by a bacteria. This causes a throat infection that we call pharyngitis or tonsillitis. Being in a low-income setting, we usually miss the chance to properly treat the bacterial tonsillitis. Those susceptible develop acute fever. The third sign that you can have is called pancarditis. Everything in the heart is inflamed. Most important of them is the valves, which do not work properly. So they let blood flow inappropriately. And then you can develop the very severe complication, which is infection inside your heart. Really, one needs urgent surgery, something that we are usually not able to do. We failed as a community because this is a preventable disease by an antibiotic that is cheap. So as a community, we have to improve access to penicillin. We have to improve access to open heart surgery in low-income settings. When you have a disease that is not happening in high-income countries, there's something about inequalities, about disparity, that we have to continue to fight for.
In 2018, at the World Health Assembly meeting, there was a resolution passed to...
You can watch the rest, I don't want to take. But what I find so beautiful about this film is we see Professor Anna Makumbi explaining technically what is happening. And then she says, we failed as a community. You know, we fail. There is freedom in recognition of failure. You know, it is not mea culpa, and we also have another thing. We have the patient telling her story and we have the doctor telling her story. And I found this absolutely fascinating. Of course, this film is professionally made. It's got the support of it's actually a BBC production. So, but it is this agency. It is the capacity that this film has allowed to say, there are underlying conditions, as she explained about the healthcare center, but in this film, she's able to say, we failed as a community. And so she can move on. This is what I talk about agency in this film. Just like with Frustin and Skylar, they talk about the problems in the healthcare in the healthcare industry, because they're very aware of this in the United States. So I'm just finishing off on this note about the potential, because this is just something I'm thinking. It's not a finalized thought, but I just find this very, very something to think about in the future, about how film can offer agency to, especially with the new technological developments that allow for the making of simpler films. And I will leave it here. So thank you.
Thank you, Cecilia, for your, as always, rich, generous, thought-provoking and moving speech. It was so full of suggestion and really thanks. We have received a couple of messages in the chat from people who had to leave, but they warmly thank you for the terrific conference, for the terrific speech. And they had the hope that the discussion would be recorded in order to follow it later. And indeed it will be recorded. Now I open the floor to questions, and you can either raise your virtual hand and ask your question, or you can send the question through the chat. Well, there are questions, comments. Okay. I'll start with an icebreaker question. So do you usually work with mixed group, that is to say with groups of students or from the medical healthcare professional nursing courses and students of humanities? And if so, how do they interact? Do they have different approaches to the visual world? Do they have a different focus on the visual world, on the visual storytelling?
We just worked, and I say we because it was with the Professor Antonio Duarte, who's also in the audience. I just worked with one mixed group, unfortunately, with that mixed group we worked with literature. But we worked with a group of medical students and humanities students. And I have to admit, it was a very rewarding experience, something that I would like to repeat. One of the things that came from this, and I think this is a real life achievement or event, it was a master student of Antonio's who was accompanying the study, and they did an interview. There's a technical term for this, but it was kind of an interview where they focus group interview. Is that right, Antonio? What do you call that interview that Christina did?
Yeah. I as far as I can remember, it was ages ago. I think it was a focus group.
And one of the things that came from this was the medical students, for instance, had an appreciation that they needed to be more present. And the literature students came to realize that they had expected their doctors to know what was wrong with them without them actually having to tell them. If you know what I mean, like one of the comments that I have that sticks in my mind was one of the students said, "I'm going to be more aware of my body, and I am going to be more aware of, and I'm going to be more present in the relationship with my doctor in the future." So there, it's not about their analysis. Then when it came to the analysis of the text, for instance, the medical students were a little in awe and they kind of saw the depth that could be in a text, whereas for the literature students, this was interesting. But then, for instance, one of the texts we worked at was from the English patient. And one of the medical students said, she says, "I'm sorry, I can't talk about things in the text. I've just finished my internship in a burn unit." And she talked about the experience of, she had to care for a young child who had been burned and like spinning the child. And there was silence in the room, you know, a time of sharing where you felt respect grew because there was a genuine sharing. And so when it comes to, I think actually, I would love to do this with medical, I would love to work with film with medical students and literature students, because also medical students are used to looking at images. They look at different kinds of images, they have a different examination, and I think that would really be an interesting thing for the future from a technical perspective, and then from the humanistic perspective, I think it would be very, very good.
Thank you. Are there other questions?
Yeah, I just wondered if you think there's any possibility or any profit. And this obviously brings up the awkward question of resources, etc., of patients being able to make their own films and really telling their own story in their filming themselves the way they'd like to be filmed. Actually, I don't know whether there's any, as I say, technical problem. It raises all kinds of other questions, but I wonder if you think there's any future or value in going in that direction.
Absolutely. Actually, I was just seeing if I could share the Health for All film festival. It's actually many patients actually present their own films, and it is becoming easier and easier with the small handheld camera. Yes. So, but the fact that now there's a platform like the World Health Organization that receives these films. I think they got, like, I can't remember how many thousand films they got for the second edition, you know, and they have, Mike Ryan, I'll see if I can share the screen, and if I have the right, I need to get out of this, yeah, and I need to, hold on a minute. Too long, I still don't like Zoom. I know, I beg your pardon.
We all understand. We're all with you. Well, I am anyway. Yeah.
I think we are all so sick of this of the platform. Here it is. Sorry, I beg your pardon. So here you see, you have like, they have these four sections. These were the films that got into the section, so universal health coverage, the one, health equality, the one that we watched was for health equality. And you have all of these films. Now, this was a very, some of them are really, they have a student section, a patient, so they offer a place for the voice of patients, or and not just people dealing with illness directly, but also conditions that can lead to illness, disability resulting from illness. Here it's like, for instance, like the gender equality, you know. So absolutely, absolutely, Mick, you know. And there was, I think there was a program actually with, now that I'm thinking about it, with people recovering from cancer, people going back home after they had cancer surgery. This was, they were given handheld cameras to actually, you know, record their and make their own films.
Antoni raised his hand. Perhaps we have a question from Antonio.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Chiara. First of all, thank you very much, Cecilia, for this interesting presentation. I like particularly your analysis on why films can have the impact they have in this area. Of course, I also connected your analysis with the thematics we exploited in the last presentation about graphic novels and cartoons. But there are specific aspects in the film. Like you said, the question I would like to offer you has to do with something that connects with our experiences of using filming in this context, and has to do with something that you, I think you also addressed in the conference, in the shared conference during your presentation, which is you have been working, we have been working with the analysis of film stills, or with the analysis of short excerpts of movies. And as you were telling, of course, there is also the alternative of working with a whole movie. The question is, what kind of advantages and limitations you see in both approaches to exploit movies in this realm of narrative medicine and medical humanities? Thank you.
No, thank you very much, Antonio, for the question. I think you hit the nail on the head when you said, what are the advantages of using each? Because there are advantages in using each one. I think when we have very little time, which often happens, I think it is better to work with the shorter excerpts, but do not use the kind of methodology that that Alexander uses of, you know, like of having this kind of like a lesson plan where, you know, which doesn't lead to any kind of, can lead to some advancement, but not really. And so when you have very little time, when you use the excerpts, you can do the close reading, the reflective writing, you can introduce these other richer elements. If you have more time, and if the participants already know something about the methodology, I think there's no doubt, but it would be better to work with full films so that you can discuss all of the elements. Like, with, I'm really sorry about that little excerpt from Girl Interrupted, but you know, it makes so much sense when you see, if when you watch the film, you can see how, I've forgotten her name now, Nurse Marge, how she has allowed this to happen. So, you know, if you have more time and students with more maturity, we could work with the longer ones. When you have less time, younger students, I think it's better to work with the stills and excerpts because you can still do this deep reading, which will be beneficial to them in the future, and that they can apply to other things, because they then start, I think you have the same experience as well, that, you know, people say, oh, I'm not going to look at films in the same way once they start to learn how to read what's happening. So, you know, this is, it's a, if we're tied for time, they're beginning, we need to start. They need to have the techniques, because when it comes to film, they don't know how to read film. Whereas like they all, everyone in school has read, they know what a metaphor is. They know what, you know, they have the vocabulary for text, but they don't have for film, so.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting you should say that. I'd have sort of imagined, I don't mean to throw a spanner in the works, I would kind of imagine it would be the other way around, that people would be more used to watching films than actually reading, especially aujourd'hui, mm-hmm. unfortunately. Right. It's interesting that you say that's been your experience. I'd have imagined it would be, they would find it easier to interpret films and visual and moving pictures rather than a text. But I mean, that's, you know, I don't know.
They're used to, but even when it comes to film studies, most of the theorists who work with visual literacy in film studies, there are very few. It's Bardwell and Thompson, it's Timothy Corrigan, and that's kind of it. You know, there are a few others who work in the cultural studies field, but they're going in a different line. So they are definitely used to watching films. They watch more films, but they watch them for story, for the actor's performance, for the music. They watch, you know, but to look at how meaning making is created through visual image, they don't have a lot of experience of that. And even, like, I'm just remembering Anna Daniela, our colleague who teaches film, you know, she says, if she shows a film still, you know, and she asks them to look at this, they start telling the story. And she says, I'm not asking you to tell the story. I'm asking you to look at the image that you're looking at and tell me what you see. You know, so it's...
okay. Oh, it's different. That's,
Okay.
Thank you.
No.
Perhaps they are not used to analyze the role of light, the role of color, the role of, so all the different layers of language that you have indeed in film.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Are there other questions?
I also appreciated this emphasis you put on films as offering agency, this idea of the possibility that maybe patients, the carers also could be involved in creating, not only in watching or appreciating, but also in creating. And this reminded me, I remember a movie I've seen many years ago that was made in a Brazilian prison, a famous Brazilian prison that had the different levels, and the bottom level was the guards were not allowed to go there, and this was under the governance of the prisoners. So it was really a very difficult situation. And one director gave cameras to the prisoners in order that they could film what's happening in this level of the prison. And this was really impressive because you could watch these contacts from the perspective of the ones that were in prison, but they were also in control of the this level of this same prison. Of course, this demanded that they had first a workshop on how to film, how to use the cameras, but the result is with a richness that you can't have if you have someone from outside that goes there. Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. And Antonio, you were just talking, and I was just thinking about even the whole George Floyd. I know I can't really, you know, what has happened with the Black community since we've had the capacity to film what is happening, you know?
This is why also probably states, there are now laws that forbid the registry of images, because this is awareness that the registering of images and the filming of situations is a way of visualizing some events that, of course, have a political meaning. Mm-hmm. In some countries, it's forbidden to take photos in order to prevent this visualization. Which in the end it's a confirmation of the power of these technologies as a way of giving agency to the citizens.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah, very good. Thank you. Yeah, no, you're absolutely true. It's I know. When I watched this, the film from Mozambique, it was incredible. When I heard Professor Makumba say, we failed. I don't know, it was like that the capacity, the ability to recognize failure allows you to move ahead, you know, and to be able to say that. I thought that was just wonderful.
And picking up on what Antonio was just saying, the fact that that's registered on film gives it an extra kind of power, doesn't it? That it's there, it's registered, that the world can see it. You know, that admission, that statement. Yeah.
Cecilia, I received a question in the chat from Giada. The doctor-patient relationship is one of the most challenging tenets within medical studies. How would you get students analyze it? I'm thinking about practical activities, drama, or other activities.
One of the things I forgot, one of the things that is so beautiful in Muffie Meyer's film and what she's representing is, okay, Sky, those two doctors, they do not lie to their patients. They go as far as they can with the patient. They have patients who reject them, but they always there is always resolution, in the sense there is always the. So with theater, like role play, can be powerful. One of the things I found most powerful when we talked about this, and it came from theater actually, and here it was one of the things that I saw where students had to write the scripts for different people. They were given scenarios and they had to write themselves into other characters. So this is one way, because you literally sit in the seat of the other. You know, there was one of the scenarios that really stood out to me that I saw being done in a medical humanities workshop. The scenario was this: it's a junior doctor and the last patient, so they're really tired. The consultant is out, it happened in the UK, the consultant is not there, and they have to tell this patient that they have terminal cancer. And it was, when they were given this task, either they had to write their position as the doctor, understanding that this was the end, the last consultation, end of shift. So all of the, I think everyone, it was actually done, it was done as kind of to train others. So there was the group, but they didn't know the scenario they were going to get. And everyone, there was this intake of breath. So this, you know, a role play, when it is genuinely done, you know what I mean? When this kind of a situation where you present with this kind of situation. But one of the things that we noticed, you have to be careful as well, because this is something that shouldn't, like when the people who were talking to us, they said, this is not something you should present to a first to a third year student. This is something that you present later on once they've had some practice or experience of dealing with patients. When it comes to, I was really impressed with the essays I got from students who dissected the narratives of the in Muffie Meyer's film, because there was this understanding that you engage with the patient. It's not that you have, you do not have to cry with them. You know what I mean? But what you do, you have to listen to them. You have to let them tell the story. You don't need to hear a story about the canary and the neighbor next door. You know, you need, and I think looking at the way, for instance, these two doctors guide the conversation makes it extraordinarily interesting. And and there is one case that's this particular, it's a young patient who's going to die. They know that she's going to die. The congenital disease, hereditary, so the family have been through this before. And they mention this, they talk about this, and they feel this, but you also see that they are letting the story develop. Maybe I'm not explaining very, very well, but it is modeling and watching and being willing to place yourself in a situation with the other. So anyway, it's a very enthusiastic. I don't know if this answered the question properly.
Yes, I think so. From what I heard and from her face.
Yeah. But I think, again, what I loved about this film is it's the genuineness of it. You know what I mean? It's not, of course, it's a film, so it is it's a construct. But I really do think that they are, they give the students who watch the film the capacity to be themselves. And then one of the things I think is absolutely lovely is, first, they have different styles. Skylar, he does a lot of medical exams. He touches the patients a lot, you know. Whereas Thurston, he sits and listens. He puts himself at the same level, you know. You see his ear is always a little bit tilted as he's listening. You know, so this is another thing that we talk about when we talk about the film, how you don't become someone else. You inhabit yourself. And, you know, so, and again, when I heard about narrative medicine first, one of the things I always thought is, if you start to build this kind of relationship with fictional characters, we cry. Like when I read a novel, I cry. I cried when I watched Professor Anna Makumba. I cried tears when she said, I failed. But this moved me, but it didn't destroy me. So creating these kind of relationships, I think, also helps doctors and nurses and all help protect themselves. Also vitally important, because they've got to be okay, you know, and they deal with very difficult situations. Anyway, so here, Char, long answer, sorry.
Thank you, Cecilia. We could go on hours and hours, I think, because there are many connections and many links, but perhaps we can stop here. We are perfectly on time, so thanks again. I wish you all a nice and relaxing summer break, and see you on the 29th of September with Professor Teresa Casal and her reflection on life writing. So thanks again. And thanks for having shared the afternoon with us.
Thank you very much, Cecilia. Thank you to
Thank
everyone.
You, Anoira. Yeah.
Have a
Thank
good
you.
Evening.
You
Thank
too.
You very much. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Yeah, you were great.
I swore I would read every, and I was so cross about that little excerpt that it just didn't work.
Well, sometimes it happens with films.
So I was really happy. I thought about showing that excerpt, the excerpt from.
Yeah, perhaps we can we can stop the recording. So
yes, please.
I think that it's up to you to stop the recording.
Oh, I beg your pardon. Yeah.
Now I stop. Interrompere, because now it is in cloud.